Greetings to you in the marvelous, matchless, and wonderful name of Jesus, the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord to the glory of God. Welcome to our Sunday school lesson today. It is a pleasure to have you join us at First Baptist Church Denby. Our entire quarter is entitled Celebrating God, but our lesson for today is entitled Good News for All from Acts 10, 34 through 47. This is the last lesson in our quarter of celebrating God. Now, as we study our lesson today, which is found in Acts, we see that God is about to do something wonderful, something new, and something amazing. God is about to fling open the doors of the church to the Gentiles, to bring salvation to the Gentiles. Now, think about this question, which should be answered as we progress in our lesson. Think about this question. Do you think that this had been God's eternal plan and purpose all along? Ephesians 2:11 states, "Don't forget, you Gentiles used to be outsiders. You were outsiders. You were called uncircumcised heathens by the Jews, who were proud of their circumcision, even though it affected only their bodies and not their hearts." That says a lot there. The Gentiles, if you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. Now, the Gentiles were apart from God. They were excluded from citizenship. They did not have the covenant promises. They were without hope and without God. They were considered unclean. But God had a plan. God would use Apostle Peter as his instrument to bring salvation to a Gentile named Cornelius. And the same for us. God was going to bring us into his family. Ephesians 2:13 states, "But now you have been united with Christ Jesus. Once you were far away from God, but now you have been brought near to him through the blood of Christ." Think about how this is significant to us today. Now, let's be clear. The Jews had no dealings with Gentiles. They were considered unclean, but God had a greater plan. So as we progress in our lesson, let's have a word of prayer first. Father in heaven, we come to you this morning, thanking you for your loving kindness and your tender mercy. You are a good God, an amazing God, a compassionate God, that we should show forth the praises of you, for you have called us out of darkness into your glorious light. We thank you for the word of the living God. Help us to internalize it so that we can walk according to your will. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, let's progress here. Good news for all, Acts 10, 34 through 47. The lesson aim, there are three of them, to explore the gift of the Holy Spirit in our lives, to value the leadership of Peter in the early church and his relationship with Christ, and to spread the good news that Christ is for all who want to know him. Now that is truly, truly good news. Now, there's a keep in mind scripture coming from Acts 10, 34 through 35. And it states, "Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons, but in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him." That's a beautiful scripture, especially to meditate on. Our focal verses come from Acts 10, 34 through 47. And so get your Bibles and let's read together, beginning with the 34th verse. "Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, perceive that God is no respecter of person, but in every nation, he that feareth God and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. The word which God sent unto the children of Israel, preach peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That word, I say, ye know, which was published throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And we were witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. Him God raised up the third day and showed him openly, not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before God, even to us, that's Peter speaking, who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that it is he which was ordained of God to be judge of quick and dead. To him give all the prophets witness, that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive remission of sins. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on all of them which heard the word. And they of the circumcision, which believed, were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? Praise God for his mighty, powerful word. All right, let's move on. Now, let's have a brief overview of Acts. In chapter 1, the promise of the Holy Spirit was given. Jesus is about to ascend on the Mount of Olives back to heaven. And so he gives the promise of the Holy Spirit, and they're all assembled. In chapter 2, they're going to be all assembled waiting for the Holy Ghost. Now in Acts 1:8, it says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Now, these were Jesus's post-resurrection instructions. He was giving them instructions so that they would know what to do after he ascended to heaven. Chapter 2, as I stated before, the Holy Spirit comes on the day of Pentecost, and it begins the birth. It is the birth of the church. And Peter preaches, and many souls are saved. Over 3,000 souls are saved on that day. Now, chapter 3, Peter heals a lame man at the gate called Beautiful. And then Peter also preaches in the temple. Chapter 4, Peter and John were arrested and appeared before the council for preaching the gospel. Now, Ananias, this is chapter 5, Ananias and Sapphira lied to the Holy Ghost about property they sold and how much they gave to the church. Also, there were signs and wonders following them, and many were added to the church. The apostles were imprisoned, but the angel of the Lord opened the prison doors in chapter 5. Chapter 6, the appointment of Stephen. Chapter 7, Stephen reviews the history of Israel before the Sanhedrin. And they were cut to their hearts, and they were so angry, they cast him out and they stoned him. Chapter 8, the people were scattered abroad. Simon the sorcerer believed and was baptized, but he was rebuked by Peter. because he thought that the power of the Holy Spirit was for sale. So Peter rebuked him and told him that his spirit was not right. Philip explained Isaiah 53 to the Ethiopian eunuch in chapter 8 also, and he was baptized as well. Chapter 9, there's the conversion of Saul. His name will later be Paul on the Damascus Road. And Peter also heals a sick man with palsy, and Dorcas also is healed. And that brings us to our focal verses and our lesson for today. The main idea one, the witnesses, Acts 10, 34 through 39. Main idea two, the facts, verses 40 through 43. And main idea three, the baptism, verses 44 through 48. Now, the main idea one, the witnesses. Now, before we get in further into the lesson, let's connect some dots concerning verses 34 through 39. Now, who was Cornelius? Cornelius was a centurion. He was a Roman army officer. He lived in Caesarea, and he was over 100 men in the Roman army. He was a devout man. He was one who feared the Lord. He was respected by the Jews. He prayed often to God, and he gave alms, and he was very, very generous. He inspired his household to be the same way. He was visited by an angel and was told that his gifts and his prayers had been received by God. He was instructed to send men to Joppa to summon a man by the name of Simon Peter. And he was also given details about where Simon Peter was lodging. He was lodging with a man by the name of Simon the Tanner. Isn't it interesting that Peter, a Jew, was living with a man who handled dead animals? The Jews considered this as unclean. Note that God was willing. God was up to something here in this lesson. God was willing to reach out to Cornelius, who was truly seeking God. And God would also bring revelation to Apostle Peter as well. Now, the witnesses, this is the same main idea. Main idea one, Cornelius's messengers were nearing the town where Peter was staying, and Peter went on the flat roof to pray around noon, and he was hungry, so as he was waiting for his meal to be prepared, he fell into a trance and saw the sky open. He saw something very unique and very different in this trance, like a large sheep with all sorts of animals, reptiles, and birds, clean and unclean, kosher and not kosher. He was told to get up, kill, and eat. And he said, "No, Lord, no, Lord, I have never eaten anything impure and unclean." But he heard a voice saying, "Do not call something unclean if God has made it clean." Now, Peter wondered what the vision meant. And this is the same vision that was repeated three times. And what God was doing, he was shifting Peter's thinking. He was giving him greater revelation of his eternal plan. He was preparing him but what God had for him to do. Now, the Holy Spirit fell on the day of Pentecost. We know that also from chapter 2. But he said, the Holy Spirit said, "Three men are looking for you. Get up, Peter, go downstairs and go with them without hesitation. Don't worry, for I have sent them." Sometimes the Holy Spirit speaks to you and he gives you instructions to do, instructions. And we have to learn to obey those instructions. So when the men arrived, Peter asked, "Why have you come?" And the men shared Cornelius' story with Peter. They got up the next morning. Peter was obeying the Holy Spirit. And so he got up the next morning, accompanied by some of his brothers from Joppa as well. So Peter arrives at Cornelius' house. He had called together his kinsmen and near friends. Many had come together. They were ready to hear what Peter had to say. Peter had time to ponder over what this meant as he was coming to Cornelius' house. The Lord had told him some things, but it's going to unfold and Peter will understand a lot more of what God is saying. So they were ready to hear what Peter had to say. Peter reminded him that it was unlawful for a Jew to keep company with a Gentile. However, Peter said, God had shown him what he should not call any man, that he should not call any man common or unclean. See, the revelation is unfolding even more and more to Peter, and it will be the same to Cornelius as well. If you look at Leviticus 11, you'll know that there were ceremonially clean and unclean animals. The Lord spoke to Moses and to Aaron and told them that there are creatures that will make you unclean that you must not eat. Eat and you must not touch them. If you touch any of their carcasses, you will be defiled until evening. If they pick up their carcasses, they had to wash their clothes. Now, Peter made these statements also. God had shown him these things and he spoke them to Cornelius. Clearly, God shows no favoritism. God accepts those who fear him and do what is right in every nation. And so, he said he came without objection based on what God had shown him and had spoken to him. Now he also said, God had also spoken, there is peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. I'm truly glad about that. So Peter asked the question, now you tell me why you sent for me. So Cornelius tells his experience with the angel while he was praying around 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And Peter began to share the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he started, he said, it began in Galilee. After John preached the message of baptism, God appointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. And Jesus went about doing good. He was healing the sick and the afflicted. He was healing those who were oppressed of the devil. And he went about doing good. So he's sharing the story about Jesus and his life. And he said, and we were eyewitnesses. We saw it with our own eyes, all the good and wonderful and excellent things that the Messiah had done. But Peter continues, he said, they put him to death. They hung him on the cross, but on the third day, God raised him to life. And so you also need to keep that in mind as he continues to tell this story. Keep this statement in mind. The news will reach the apostles and other believers in Judea, that Gentiles receive the word of God. It's going to reach, you know how something happens and it will reach the ears of others. Peter is going to go back to Jerusalem and the Jewish believers are going to criticize him. Have you ever obeyed the Lord, but you got criticism because people didn't understand your mission? They didn't understand what God was saying to you. But Peter obeyed the word of the living God. But think about this. Peter entered, this is what they're going to criticize him about, that Peter had entered the home of Gentiles and even ate with them. They're going to say this about Peter. But in chapter 11, Peter will explain his actions and tell them what happened. Main idea two, the facts, verses 40 through 43. Apostle Peter continues to share the good news. He said God had raised Jesus from death 3 days later, as I forestated, and he allowed Jesus to be seen by witnesses he had chosen. And God had chosen those who ate and drank with him also after he rose from the dead. God commanded them to preach the gospel to the people. These are the instructions that Jesus had given unto the disciples. They were to testify that Jesus is the one God appointed judge of the living and of the dead. So God is doing something wonderful here through the Apostle Peter in sharing the good news. And he mentioned also, Peter told them that all the prophets had spoken about him, especially Isaiah 53. And he also said, all who believe in him will have their sins forgiven through the power of his name. There is power in the name of Jesus. Now, the word of the living God in Acts 2:21. Now, think about this. In Acts, on the day of Pentecost, Peter preaches, and he says this, and it's coming to fruition in our study in chapter 10. Peter says this, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, John 6:40 also states, Jesus said, these are the words of Jesus, for it is my Father's will, saying it is the will of the Father that all who see his Son and believe in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Isn't that good news? Beautiful. Main idea three, the baptism, verses 44 through 48. While Peter was speaking, the Holy Ghost came down on those listening to his message. The Jewish believers who had come down from Joppa with Peter were amazed that God had poured out the Holy Spirit on the Gentiles also. And they were speaking in tongues and they were praising God for his greatness. They had a reason to celebrate. Note that our whole quarter has been talking about celebrating God. And that's what they are doing in this lesson. And we are also celebrating God because we are the beneficiaries of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary, dying for all mankind. So they had a reason to celebrate, and we do too. Now, in Isaiah 49:6, it states, and he said, it is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved of Israel. It will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the ends of the earth. The New Living Translation says it this way, and you will bring my salvation to the ends of the earth, not just to the Jews, not just to those who are in Judea, not just to those who are in Samaria, but to the ends of the earth. And that would include us, because this was saying that God, through Jesus Christ, would be reaching out to the Gentile world, to those whosoever will. It's that whosoever will, let them come. Beautiful words, like music to our ears. So Peter spoke up. Do I hear any objections to baptizing these friends with water? And there were no objections. He said, they have received the Holy Spirit exactly as we did on the day of Pentecost. So Peter ordered them baptized in the name of Jesus. Revelation 7, 9 through 10. You know, in prior lessons, we were studying about Revelation, and this is a quote from Revelation. After this, I saw a vast crowd, too great to count, from every nation and tribe and people and language, standing in front of the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes and held palm branches in their hands. And they were shouting with a great roar, salvation comes from our God who sits on the front throne and from the Lamb. The only one, the Lamb, was the only one able to open the scroll and loose the seven seals in Revelation, one of our prior lessons. So this is a universal call to whoever will. Whosoever will, let him come, including people from every nation, every people, every kindred, and every tongue. Let me share a little story about two Ethiopian girls. They were twins. And this is a true story, by the way. This is a story about two beautiful babies, baby girls born in Ethiopia. Soon after they were born, the mother left them, abandoned them. But the father, the earthly father, did everything he could to do to take care of them. But they went through many trials and many tribulations and hardships. Often they faced the fear of eviction and so much more. But at the age of 12, the father had done all that he could. Their father died and left them as orphans. And there was a man named Solomon who had been helping them and working with the family. He worked with at a place called Compassion Center. And he treated them like their father, providing them with the necessities they needed for life. And the Compassion Center and the church became their family. Looking back, they said the Lord had a purpose and a plan for their lives. They remembered his faithfulness, the Lord's faithfulness and his loving kindness in providing for them. They graduated from high school and went on to be accountants. Now, spiritually speaking, we too, as Gentiles, were strangers, foreigners, aliens from the household of faith, like orphans. But now God has brought us near unto the Father through the blood of his Son, Jesus, our blessed Messiah. And now we are part of the family of God. Now, this concludes our lesson with, and I want to conclude it with Revelation 22 and 17, but this concludes our lesson. In other words, to sum it all up, the Holy Spirit is extending this invitation through the bride, the church. The Spirit, and this comes from Revelation 22 and 17, the Spirit of the bride say, and we are the bride of Christ, that was our prior lesson, come, that's the invitation to whosoever will, and let the one who hears say, come, let the one who is thirsty come, and let the one who wishes take the free gift of the water of life. That comes from Revelation 22 and 17. Now, Romans 10, 9 and 12 states, if you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Jew and Gentiles are the same in this respect. They have the same Lord who gives generously to all who call upon his name. All right, now, if you desire to make Jesus your Lord and Savior, pray this prayer with me. Dear Lord, I know that I have sinned and fallen short of your glory. I repent and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe Jesus Christ is your Son. I believe that he died on the cross of Calvary for my sins, and you raised him to life. I want to trust him as my Savior. Guide my life, Lord, and help me do your will. I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, welcome to the family of God. Now, this concludes our lesson. It concludes our entire quarter. May the Lord bless you and keep you.